intelligence. That is a really, really huge topic nowadays, especially with the dawn of the new things called artificial intelligence. Nowadays, a lot of things in the media always mention intelligence this, intelligence that. But what is actually artificial intelligence? Is it truly intelligent? Now, first of all, we will talk about humans. Humans, they are 100% intelligent, right? So, raise your hand if you think you're intelligent. Oh, I see some of you not raising. Maybe you're a robot. So, all of you guys are intelligent. So, what does it mean by intelligent? Intelligent means that if you have options in your life, you want to be able to choose them. Like, for an example, if you wake up, you can choose what kind of breakfast you want to have. I want to have some sausage, I want to have some eggs, or do I want to have cereals? You think about them, and they become your choices. So now, let's think about it this way. We watch some movies in our childhood, for example, Terminator or I, Robot. In Terminator, I remembered when I was little, there was like a really beautiful friendship between John Connor and the Terminator, played by Arnold Schwarzenegger. And that makes me realize, if this Terminator was a robot, why do I feel sad when he died? Spoiler. So this means that the line between AI and human was blurred at this point of time. So with this, I will start my talk with an opening quote. Generative AI has the potential to transform the way we interact with machines and make them more human-like, by Sam Altman, the CEO of OpenAI. So, the thing is, we kind of realize each time there is some progress with AI, it became more and more human-like. Like nowadays, for example, if you look at ChatGPT, you can even talk to it and it will talk back to you in not a way something like, oh yes, I'm ChatGPT, this is our answer. No, but it sounded like just like a human nowadays. And that is a huge, huge progress compared to back then. So, but then if you look at it, it's not really alive. Now we need to really define what it mean exactly to be alive. So there are three things that I declare that is needed to be alive. These are the three key components to be alive. First, you have to have free will. Free will means that you have the choices and you can choose them. For an example, I want to eat cereal, then I will eat cereal. That is a free will. You're not forced to do it because it's the best thing ever for you. Like for an example, if I just look at your pet, like a cat, for an example, if they want to eat, they go eat. If they want to be lazy, they be lazy. Same with us. If we are too lazy to study for our exams, some people procrastinate. I know that from experience. Next would be autonomy. Autonomy is the power to exert your free will. You are not really alive and free if you don't have autonomy. If someone else says that, oh, you are only allowed to do this, then you don't have autonomy. This is what we can really see in AI nowadays. AI would always respond to us based on our prompt. Like for example, in real life, slave wouldn't have an autonomy. They have free will. They can choose to disobey the master, but they are pushed to do what their master wants. This is not autonomy. Now next would be intelligence. Intelligence itself is the capability to have choices. If you think, then you have choices. And if you think and have choices, then that means there is lots of decisions that you can make out of it. Now, I will talk about AI in three different eras. First, the early AI, and then the current AI, the current state of AI, and what is a possible future for AI. Early AI. Everyone knows this example. In 1997, Garry Kasparov was beaten by AI. This is a huge, huge step in the field of artificial intelligence because this is the first time AI defeated the world champion in a field. And this is also a field of intelligence because chess is an extremely hard game. Here, we can really see that the AI itself is extremely intelligent. However, it doesn't have free will. And also it is also a specialized kind of intelligence. It is only intelligent in chess. For an example, if we ask Deep Blue, the AI made by IBM that defeated Garry Kasparov, what is the weather today? It wouldn't be able to answer us. It is a really, really simple question. But this is impossible for it to answer us. So this is a type of specialized intelligence. Well, if I compare it to a living being, I would say it is comparable to plants. Plants, they have a lack of free will. However, they are also really intelligent. Plants, they would grow their roots towards nutrient-rich soils. They would orient themselves towards the sunlight. So they are really optimized towards survival. That's why we see lots of plants nowadays, because they're capable of surviving for so many decades through different generations. That is very intelligent. However, they don't have the free will. So for example, a plant, can it say, well, I don't feel like growing that way. I just want to grow the other way just for fun. Sadly, no, that's not a possibility. So yes, plants are really intelligent, but it doesn't have free will. Now, let's talk about the current state of AI. In the past tens of years, there is a research on this worm, C. elegans. What is special about this worm is that this worm itself, the neurons, all of it, were completely mapped by scientists. This is a microscopic worm, so technically you wouldn't be able to really see it. What's special about this worm is that since all of it is mapped, that means we are able to digitalize it. We can make an AI that performs the same way as this worm. This project itself is called Open Worm. It was talked in another TED Talk. It is an ongoing project, and we can see that they are able to emulate this worm in a digitalized space. And it acts almost exactly like a real worm. Now, let's talk about nowadays, large language models. Of course, everyone knows all about it. There are so many things about them. Like for an example, ChatGPT, Gemini, Cloud, and many, many others that is going to follow suit. But first of all, let's talk about the human brain. There are lots of neurons inside of the human brain, around 86 billion. So what is special about it? It is capable of thinking very, very abstract things and also get into an abstract conclusion. A lot of things in the world are created throughout the human mind. Like for example, even this TED event is created through many of those brilliant minds together. We need to think about this. There is 86 billion neurons. How does learning work? So, learning. For humans, learning is a type of skill that can be done, for an example, through repetition. For an example, 5 times 5, when we are like around 4 years old or something, that would be an immensely hard task for us. But as we grow older, we learn about math, we learn about many things, chemistry, languages, etc. We get to learn that and it becomes easier for our brain. What changes is that the connection between the neurons itself. This is called neuroplasticity. Even though most people have around 86 billion neurons, everyone is different. For an example, for me, maybe math is way easier to learn. But for some other people, languages would be way easier to learn. For me, that would be very hard. That is how a human brain work. Let's talk about ChatGPT. So, OpenAI GPT-3 neurons, it was said that they have around 175 billion. That means they are capable of making extremely complex calculation, extremely complex thinking, extremely complex intelligence behind it. However, the problem with that is that it is always optimized. It doesn't have free will. It doesn't have autonomy. Whatever we want to make ChatGPT is what ChatGPT is, because it is made by human, no autonomy. Free will, it always tries to give us the correct answer, no matter what, because we want it to be the best tool ever. In the end, it is a tool. But if you talk about the future, The future of AI. The future of AI itself is something that is very exciting. Imagine this. If the AI at one point be able to improve upon itself, then it will be able to have free will to see which way it wants to improve itself. And if it have like the will to choose where to improve upon itself, then they have autonomy, because we don't need the human scientist anymore to improve upon itself. So the thing is, because AI will be able to improve upon itself very fast, there is a huge technological jump in this era. This is such an exciting era. It's a critical point in our life. Now, there will be a huge technological jump in many areas, such as agriculture. Imagine this. It is possible to solve the world hunger by having advanced agriculture and also logistics system. And by doing that, we also reduce food waste. That means it also improves upon climate change. And also, what if they also improve the infrastructure itself based on better technologies? Then it would also solve the housing problem. Many, many problems would be solved with the future of AI. Coming back to the question, the first question that I put in inside of this talk, is AI truly intelligence? So the answer itself would be, currently, AI is not alive, but has a very real potential to be alive in the future. Just like with this future, we will have a glorious future, and it is very, very possible that we have a harmonious coexistence with the future of AI. Just like how John Connor was good friends with this Terminator played by Arnold Schwarzenegger. Thank you very much.